Hello, it's Jeremy from AltRider, and we're going to do the installation for the AltRider T7 variable height lowering link that also allows you to raise your motorcycle. It's a pretty simple idea. With the three different positions, we can go from raising the bike's position by a half of an inch, or we can actually lower the bike 18 millimeters or 0.7 inches, or we can lower it all the way down 30 millimeters or 1.1 inches. So super quick installation. In your kit, you're gonna get the two parts, and there's indications as to the positioning, and I'll go in that in a sec. For my install though, I'm gonna want two 17 millimeter spanners to take off the bolts on the lowering links, or the dogs as they call them. Good opportunity to re-grease the needle bearing, so I always have some waterproof high quality grease, a rag with me. And then when we set up our front suspension, we'll need a 10 millimeter on a torque wrench so that we can set the fork tube height. And then a miter square helps for setting, and we'll just briefly get into suspension setup and the adjustment I want to do to the front of the motorcycle when I affect and change the rear of my motorcycle. Let's jump into it. So first step we need to do is jack the bike up. Several different ways we can do it. Heck, if you got crash bars on it, you could lay it on its side to do this change. It's a pretty easy install, but you're going to need to offload the rear wheel. We need to free up that swing arm. So a ATV or a flat head jack, these are pretty affordable from Harbor Freight. That's the most ideal, because you can get it under it with a skid plate, even the OEM skid plate, and get that balance. So I'll get that positioned in place right to the linkage guard, right? I don't want to be interfering with the linkage guard. I want to be on the flat portion of the bottom of the bike so I get a nice balanced lift. Get my kickstand out of the way. Get centered just in front of that lowering link. And take your time, and you'll even just feel the bike get want to balance on there as soon as I just bring pressure up. So right here, I start rocking it back and forth, making sure it feels confident. And then you don't need to get it way in the air, guys. It's way more stable. I just want to get that rear wheel off the ground. I'll use my 17-inch spanner because my clearance for using a ratchet is pretty tight in here. And when you can first break the nut off of the, break the friction off the bolt before you then need to hold both sides, because it's a little bit awkward or uncomfortable. So you can come from this side and just get that initial break. One way, because you can actually start to, and then as soon as I get that to break, it's eventually going to start to spin on me and I'll have to go over there. But to get that initial start, and on here, because we've got the skid plate and all the protection, I'll use the open end. And again, there we go, and we'll break that. But now I'm going to have to go over to the other side to hold it. So now I go in with my ratchet and I just back this guy the rest of the way out. So again, I've already did the hard part, which is to break the nut loose, and now I'm just gonna walk this out. Again, guys, we're reusing the OEM bolt. Once you get this started, you can then finger walk it out because it's got the thread locking portion. So after about the first few revolutions, you don't need to hold the bolt. You guys see the little bit of spring steel that's on each side of your nut. And that is a locking nut, but not a nylock, right? And the reason why is because of the heat and the environment down there, the nylock would go soft and lose its anti-locking or its locking properties. And this is why we don't need Loctite on the system. As soon as you get a few threads going, this guy will come right off. But you guys can see that bit of spring steel in there, and that's what's giving you the locking properties on this nut. Okay, so now with my nuts cleared, I can usually just leverage with my toe, and all I want to do is just take the load off, and it makes it a lot easier to just slide these bolts out. And it's the same principle when you're changing tires and you want to take the axle out. Just putting a little bit of lift with your toe on the rear wheel makes a huge difference. So once the link is released off of the swing arm, now I can take it off of the strut or the shock portion. Based upon the condition and age of your bike, you might want to wire wheel this. If you wire wheel this because it's got a zinc plating on here, I'm going to go ahead and wire wheel this, but grease this before I go back in. Additionally, this gives you a great time to inspect your bearing needles on your linkage. And so if you slide your entire bushing out, that gives you access to inspect your bearing needles. So as I roll my bushing in and out, I want to feel that it's nice and smooth and I have no resistance, and it tells me I've got those in good shape, but I'll go ahead and repack those with blue watertight Bell Ray grease. So I'll lube up my bushings just because I'm in here. This is a great time, though, like I said, to inspect your linkage. And this is one of the drawbacks to linkage systems, is there's that much more maintenance required because now you've got a full bearing system. Two sets of needle bearings, of course. A lot of different schools of thought on those needle bearings. You could pack the internal castings where the needle bearings are. The idea there being waterproof grease that water cannot get in there. Or you can just grease the bushings. On the bolts, this is common, you'll see this on the Japanese bikes versus the KTMs or the BMWs, but see that little bit of oxidation. So I hit it with the wire wheel, but you want to be really light. I don't want to take off more plating than necessary. And then, as I mentioned, I'm going to come back and lube these. And also, like I was saying, this is a lot like what you'll see on the axles on your Hondas or your Yamahas, especially in the dirt bike arena as well. I'm going to take a quick second. We really tried to get this as clear as possible. Because you have three different positions, we wanted to make sure it's foolproof. So the arrow is indicating front of bike. This is the outside of the lowering link. And so when I'm in this position, so meaning this position, I have two options eligible because this is the font that's upright, is my plus 12, everything's a metric, 12 millimeters, my half inch rise, or my negative 18, my 18 millimeters lowering. So this is my position to raise it, and or this is my position to lower it. I'm not using this one because it's upside down. Now, if I wanted to lower it to the maximum lowering, I'm actually going to flip it, and this is, again, my front of bike, and there is the only legible upright. Those are now upside down. That's my position for the lowered 30 millimeter position. And so front of bike is indicated by the arrow there. Lowered 30, no other options because they're upside down. If I want those two other options, front of bike, now the two options are upright and negative 30 is upside down. So this gives me the option to do plus 12 millimeters, the rise of half inch, or the negative 18 millimeters lowering again. So pretty straightforward, guys, but pay attention. And that way you don't need the manual or anything. You get to know later if you want to make these adjustments, because that's the beauty of this setup, guys, is it takes almost no time once this is on your bike because you're only just pulling one bolt. And try it out, guys. It's actually pretty surprising how the half inch is not that difficult to touch the ground. I'm 5'10", 30-inch inseam, and I can still touch my toes, but it's given me a half inch of ground clearance for really aggressive riding. So stuff to check it out. Let's go ahead and get these installed. All right, so now we got everything all lubed up. We're gonna start this first install. I'm gonna show you all three positions, but I'm gonna start with the negative 30, which is the lowest position. So there I am, arrow's facing forward. There's my 30. Get it started on this one side. Get my lower bolt aligned. Now I can get my other one ready to go, but I see that clearly I've gotta lift this, and so this is where you guys wanna use your boot behind you, and then I can get that other one aligned. And super easy. I'm now going to jump to the other side, forward arrow. I'm going with my lowest position, negative 30. So I'm going to get this in place, set on there, make sure my bushings are set correctly. And then, guys, it's reassembly like we just put it together. So I'm going to go washer first. Be sure to put this on correctly. There's my flat side. There's my correct side. Go ahead and finger tighten them until they need the wrench. I'll get both started and then bring my wrench over. So with my spanner on the other side, I'm gonna get that cranked down and then we'll torque it to spec. And we'll do the same on the other side. All right, so if I'm gonna tighten from this side for access, I wanna make sure that I do that final torque, as you guys have heard before. Do the torque on the nut side, otherwise your torque value is incorrect and you're putting, there's a lot of friction on that bolt. Make sure you're only doing that final tighten where you're actually doing the torque load is on the nut side of the bolt. And there we go.
Let's talk about what we've just done to the bike. We've lowered the rear by 30 millimeters, and so now the bike has more rake. So if we we took the bike, we lowered it like this. If we add our forks, here they were at stock. If we drop it by 30 millimeters, we're going to put more rake on it. If we raise the bike by a half inch, we're going to put even less rake and make it more biased and aggressive. So what does that do? So when I lower it and have the front have more rake, it's the chopper effect. And what that's going to do is that will slow down the steering in tight technical or in the parking lot. The steering is slowed down or slower, but it'll be a lot more stable at high speeds. On the freeway, way less likely to introduce speed wobble. It's actually a great trick on older sacked out bikes with sacked out suspension. One of the easiest things you can do is drop the forks in the fork tube, bias it up, and it takes a lot of speed wobble out. But off-road is the California desert racers. They want that slowed down speed of steering so that in the high speed desert situations, the front is a lot more stable, less likely to get into a tank slapper in the sand at high speed. Alternatively, when we raise the bike and the front ends up with the fork tubes either dropped or we raise the rear and now we're biased forward, now there's a lot more bias on the front. It makes the bike steer a lot faster. So opposite of the chopper is the crotch rocket. So that's very flickable. It's very fast in steering as you think about a crotch rocket or a sport bike going around a racetrack. It needs to flick quickly from side to side. So it steers very quick, but it loses stability. So at high speed, a dirt bike or the T7, if you're biased really heavily to the front, you can end up feeling some wobble and or even get tank slap at super high speeds. And or high speeds off-road, you're not going to have as a stable of a situation. So you can run a steering dampener or play with your adjustment. So now we're going to talk about making those adjustments. As a general rule of thumb, the adjustment that you do in the rear, you'll want to do a 50% adjustment in the front, see how that feels for you, and then adjust for yourself. So if I'm going to lower the rear 30 millimeters, I want to lower the front 15 millimeters. Using either a set of calipers or a miter square will help me take a look, because on the T7, the fork tubes don't come with the notches indicating the different heights, and that way I want to absolutely make sure that this is at the same setting as my other tube so that they're running parallel. Before we get started, there's a limitation to the amount of adjustment. And as a general thumb, approximately they come at 7 millimeters or 0.25, a quarter inch above the fork tube. But again, guys, it's how they come out of the factory or out of the pallet and how did your dealer set up. But let's take a look. You don't have infinite adjustability. You can see here that there's flats machined into the fork tube at the two locations of the clamp. And these are specifically to indicate do not set the fork tubes below this flat, because this is now a much thinner tube wall and the clamping forces of your triple clamp could begin to crush and close those fork tubes. You may not see it, but for sure you would begin to deform your fork tube, which would then cause additional stiction on both the piston that's in the fork and even cause binding in your springs. So pay attention, that's your maximum location of lowering. Here are some baseline recommendations for the front suspension when you use the AltRider variable height suspension lowering links. Keep in mind, these are just baseline recommendations, and the final setting is based upon your personal preference. Remember, our factory baseline is 7 millimeters from the top of the triple tree to the top of the fork tube. That is, of course, if your dealer set the bike up. So when making adjustments, we'll be adjusting from this baseline of 7 millimeters. Be sure to measure from the top of the triple tree to the top of the gold fork tube. Do not include the dimensions of the silver fork cap. If we lower the rear to the lowest setting of 30 millimeters, we want to lower the front suspension to the T7's lowest limit. The lowest limit is determined by both the flats on the fork tubes and your bodywork will crash if the fork tube is set too low. This is roughly 22 millimeters from the top of the triple tree, about 15 millimeters lower than the factory setting. If we lower the rear to the second lowest setting of 18 millimeters, we want to lower the front 15 millimeters from the triple tree to the top of the fork tube. This is roughly 8 millimeters lower than the factory position. And lastly, if we raise the suspension, the 12 millimeters, we want to raise the front suspension to its upper limit, which is to the top of the fork tube. But do not go too far that you're clamping on your fork cap. This will be raising the front suspension roughly 7 millimeters from factory. Because we've just lowered it 30 millimeters in the rear, I'm gonna go ahead and take this to the maximum. I now need my 10 millimeter
ratchet. When you go to loosen these, there's a clamping effect. So as you break this one loose and back it all the way off, this other one, you'll watch, you can see the clamp open up. You want to loosen all four clamp locations. I want to be able to have the fork tubes walk themselves down because you get a little binding effect. And I say down, we're raising the forks into the triple tree. I've got all four of my clamp locations, and with a little bit of twisting, you can get the fork tubes to climb themselves up. And you'll want to bring them both up at the same time to avoid them binding. So then, because I was spinning them, I'm going to want to make sure that I have my pressure relief. These flathead screws, guys, that is because pressure, the atmosphere inside the tube, will build up as both the heat and your elevation changes, and you want to periodically relieve the pressure inside of your fork tube assembly so your forks actually perform better. What I'm going to do is I always want to spin that to the top. It gives me the easiest reach with my screwdriver. So after I've been adjusting, I want to bring those over there. I'm going to go ahead and tighten these again with the 10 millimeter, and then you want to do this with a torque wrench because these are very specific torques. And the reason is, guys, there's activity movement that happens in this lower portion, so you don't get as tight of a clamp. Plus, there's engineered flexibility going on here. So you don't just go cranking these all the way. And what you want to do is set your torque wrench. And so I'm going to ratchet until I hear my click at 20. But then I'm going to come back up here and ratchet until I hear my click at 20. I've got to come back to my first one, ratchet again until I hear my click at 20. Because that bolt has actually pulled it forward, loosening that one, or taking tension off of that one, I should say. And now I need to retorque that back to 20, retorque that back to 20, retorque that, and it's a sequence, and you'll have to sequence through it 2 to 3 times to truly get the clamp seated properly. I'm a pretty average build at just about 5'10 in height with approximately a 30-inch inseam. And so now, when we've done the 30 millimeter lower in the rear and the approximately 17 to 15 millimeters of raising the fork tubes, I have a very comfortable flat foot situation in my sneakers. Of course, with riding boots, it would be even more of a flat foot situation. Let's go ahead and look at the three different positions. So again, this is 30. Now we're going to make the adjustment to just only lowering to 18, and we'll do the about a 9 millimeter adjustment on the fork tubes, and then we'll do the full rise at the height rise of 12 millimeters, which is a full half inch of rise. So I'm going to take the nuts off just as we did on the installation video, my washers. I'll take that, the right side dog bone off first, makes it a lot easier, and then we'll come over to the other side and take that off. We want to go to 18 and then eventually to 12. So we're going to take these bolts out. And as I flip that over, my arrow is facing forward. My 18 is upright. Now I'm going to walk these bolts right back in to there. I'm going to go to my negative 18 using my boot. Get this guy aligned. I came here, same principles, guys, with loosening the triple tree. We're at about an 18 millimeter reduction in the rear and a 9 millimeter reduction in the front. And I would say it is notably different from the 30 millimeter, subtle. I'm now, instead of flat-footed, I would say I'm clearly and confidently on the balls of my feet. So again, 5'10", 30-inch inseam. We were on the negative 18, and now we're going to go to the plus 12. The good news is I don't even need to take the full links off. It's just a super swap from this bolt position to here. So I'm going from a lowered 18 millimeters to a raised 12, or that half-inch rise. And I highly encourage you guys to experiment with this yourselves. It's, as you're seeing here, it's really easy to make this adjustment. So there we go. And I'm using my boot to help me hold up and get that position perfectly. Okay, now I'm gonna wanna go ahead and retorque those bolts, set my washer and nut. Now, I'm gonna go to the highest setting I can on my fork tubes, and same sequence. We're gonna go through the triple trees, and now we're gonna raise it to the max.
You don't ever set it at your fork cap. It's just onto the tube body, and arguably I've got 1 millimeter. I've set that, again, making sure that you guys are setting them equal or parallel across the triple tree using an indication so you have an understanding. Let's see where we are on the ride height now. I did a 12 millimeter rise in the rear, about a half inch, and then I've taken my fork tubes to the triple tree, or about a millimeter approximately, so I've taken 7 millimeters and dropped the fork tubes, which is raising the bike. And now, 5'10", 170 pounds, I am comfortably on the toes, or the balls of the toes foot, not on the ball of my foot, but I'm flatting my toes, if you will, if that makes sense. So I still feel very confident to be able to get around and ride this bike, even in some pretty techy situations, but I'm really excited about the new possibilities and areas you can go without bottoming out by adding a full half an inch of ground clearance by raising up the rear of the bike. And then, of course, anytime you're changing your suspension, right, we're changing the ride height of this bike, you gotta accommodate the kickstand. So as it leans over, if we've lowered the bike, that original standard kickstand may not even be able to deploy, or it's gonna have the bike almost vertical, nearly tipping over. Well, fully adjustable side stand that we did from AltRider is a gorgeous piece. You get the larger side stand foot and a fully adjustable kickstand that goes from lowered 2 inches to raised 1 full inch and all half inch increments in between. If you've got any questions, reach out to us at altrider.com. Proud to be doing things here in the States, and also that we're real riders. And so if you've got any questions, please reach out to us. The designers are available. We pride ourselves on the customer service. You're gonna find somebody actually answering the phones and getting you an answer. And if we don't know the answer, we'll tell you and we'll work on getting you an answer shortly. Thanks.